What inspired you to write Seedfolks?
Well, that makes it sound like there's one answer to that question. But a book is a lot like a river. It's got a lot of different tributaries that flow into it. And so it wasn't one thing, but many, many things. Close at hand, I was looking for another idea that would lend itself to a book with a large cast in a kind of a style that bridged plays and prose. I'd done that in an earlier book called Bull Run about the first battle of the Civil War. I had 16 different characters, 8 Northern, 8 Southern, and I had so much fun doing it that I wanted to do another book a little bit like that. So I was casting about for ideas, and I happened to be reading a newspaper and came across a story about a local psychologist or psychiatrist in my area who had her patient's garden as part of her therapy. And when I read that, I suddenly remembered community gardens. I'd been in one or two in the past, not recently, and suddenly I could see the book. There it was. I'm often looking for a book that offers me variety and unity. So the unity would be the setting, the place, the garden. The variety, the cast. It was all right there. But many other things flowed into the book from near and far. It's when you're thinking out a book, it's a little bit like walking along a beach. There's some things that washed up just last night, and there's some things that have been there for years and years. And so among the years and years things, well, my parents were both big gardeners. I grew up in Santa Monica, California, on the edge of Los Angeles. And after my sisters and I graduated from high school, my parents gradually dug up the lawn and turned it into something of an urban farm. There is still a cornfield that my father still maintains in front of our house. Fruit trees started going in. That was when I was still there. And now, although my father lives there alone, there are probably 6 fig trees, a gigantic avocado tree. And when I was growing up, I could walk out in the morning in the summer and choose from apricots, tangerines, plums, lemons, limes, berries, loquats, apricots. What am I forgetting? Plus, my parents were grafters. So, you know, on one plum tree, they'd have 3 different varieties. So I grew up around that. Actually, more important to Seedfolks was the fact that my mother was a volunteer when I was in high school at a VA, at a Veterans Administration hospital. And she helped teach the men there about gardening. Again, kind of like a psychotherapist, as a therapy for healing. These were veterans from World War II, Korea, Vietnam. And I remembered hearing about that. So all of those things flowed into the book, and many other things as well.
Thank you. That was a delightful answer. Why did you decide to place Seedfolks in Cleveland?
Why Cleveland? Poor Cleveland. People ask that question. Is there, what are you, crazy? Why would you put it in Cleveland? Well, because big cities like New York, Chicago, they got enough press already. So I wanted it somewhere that wasn't stale, somewhere a little bit new. I wanted it in a northern city, a city with a short summer, where that green would really be valued, would really be noticed, would really mean a lot. And I needed it in a city where I had some kind of connection. I had not lived in Cleveland, but I happened to have various friends who had either grown up there, lived there at the time I was writing, or had a long background there. People I could ask questions of. As a writer, you're always researching things you don't know about. But you can only find some things in books and on the internet, and some things you need a person for. In Seedfolks, for instance, there's a line that says, it mentions that you can see across Lake Erie to Canada on the other side, or maybe you can't, I can't remember. I know I needed to find that out. Could you see across? You're not gonna find that in the book. There's not gonna be any index that says Lake Erie, comma, ability to see across. That's one where you just call up your friend, which is what I did. So I had some research advantages with Cleveland. And then, of course, Cleveland was famously a city of immigrants. You know, in the middle 19th century, late 1800s, Cleveland was, you know, largely immigrants, way over 50%. And so it had that history there. So for those reasons, Cleveland it was.
Okay, whenever you're ready.
How and why did you develop this technique of multiple voices? Is this technique developed naturally, or was this multiple voices style one that you consciously developed?
Well, where did it come from? It really came from the world of music. I have two sisters. They both played the flute. I played the piano. My father played classical guitar, and my mother played the piano. So I grew up with a lot of multiple voices, a lot of sounds from different directions. And that had a huge effect on me. And I switched from piano or added recorder in high school. And then I began playing with other people. Piano is otherwise kind of an island. I was always envious of my sisters who could play flute duets. And really, hearing my sisters play flute duets was probably the start of it all. To tell you the truth, since my father was a writer, Sid Fleischman, I didn't grow up wanting to be a writer. I would have much rather composed music. And eventually, I began writing books that were scored like music. The first was I Am Phoenix. That was poems for two voices about birds. Then came Joyful Noise, poems for two voices about insects. Later, Big Talk, which was poems for four voices, like a string quartet. And then Bull Run, the book I mentioned earlier, for 16 voices. That was my attempt, really, to write a symphony, which has roughly 16 parts. When I was in high school, my father came home one day from the library with the score to Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. Actually, it was to Romeo and Juliet Overture by Tchaikovsky. And we listened to the music and followed along with the score. And right then, I knew what I wanted to write. It wasn't books, it was scores. The idea of having that kind of mind that could hear all those things happening at once and very carefully craft, this comes in here, this comes in here, these move in here. That attracted me no end. And in high school, I read Dylan Thomas's Under Milkwood, which was a play really just for voices. It was originally for radio. And that was the other thing. That just did it for me. I can remember exactly where I was in the living room when I read it. And it's never ceased to glow in my mind. I've been trying to write my own version of Under Milkwood ever since in various different ways. So it came from that. Came from playing in a recorder consort in my college years, group of about eight of us. I played alto recorder and bass, and playing in a group was the most fun I've ever had, and I wanted to try to get that on the page later. And thus the duets, and then later the quartets of Big Talk, and I was playing the violin at that time. My kids took violin. I decided to take it with them. I'd never played a string instrument. Had a great time and eventually worked up to where I could play the second violin parts in easy string quartets, and that was fabulous too. So it came from that. Came from the world of radio. In my house, there was all kinds of music. There was all kinds of radio. I grew up listening not to just to one kind of thing, but to all kinds of things, you know, from baseball to pop music to rock and roll to shortwave. I had a shortwave radio. I even wrote a book about the world of radio called Seek, another spoken word piece that's a little bit like a play. 52 voices this time, so a big oral piece. So that's where it came from, all kinds of places.
Well, you answered my next question, because my next question was going to be, while reading Seedfolk, I sensed lyrical notes in my head from start to finish. I heard music while I was reading the book. It was background music, but it was there. So that answers why I was listening to music. You were writing music.
That's what I try to do. And to tell you the truth, those monologues, when you write a monologue, everything has to hang together very tightly, actually, when you write anything. I'm a very slow, very careful writer. And I really learned that by hearing my sister in the room next door playing the Bach unaccompanied partita for flute and hearing that, because it was unaccompanied. It was just like a monologue. And of course, it was years later that I became a writer of books. You know, that was back during high school. But I still am aiming for that kind of tightness, concision. Everything follows naturally, nothing out of place. I feel like I'm writing those Bach movements when I'm writing the monologues.
And I was listening to them.
Huh? Well, great.
What were some of the challenges about writing in dialect?
Well, yeah, that was a challenge. The one that's really in dialect in Seedfolks is the Korean woman. And I happened to have a Korean neighbor at that time. And so I began noticing what his English was like. I also went on, the internet was pretty new then, but I went on and was able to find some, not recordings, but transcriptions of Korean accented English. And so I did study those things. I was amazed that my neighbor was a successful seller of insurance, despite great problems with the language. But he was. And I've often felt that people might have thought that the dialect I put for the character, Se Young, was too extreme. But no, it was much easier to understand than my neighbor. But so I did do some research, certainly, on that one. On Gonzalo, well, he was pretty fluent in English, so there really wasn't much of that there. But since I do have an ear for music and for languages, naturally, I'm going to try to craft the speech, you know, according to what seems right to me. People are going to talk different ways. Even the British woman, the maid, I enjoyed writing her part. British English is very different. I spent about 10 days in England once, and it was so different that I remember being quite nervous as I slowly got closer to the front of a line at the post office that I was going to have to speak to a British person and be understood. And understand the answer, just like in a foreign language, you know. You memorize your question and then you can't understand the answer that comes flying back at you. So, yeah, that's what I like doing that.
You seem to have an ability to identify and write with great accuracy about common teen experiences, as you did in Seedfolks and A Fate Totally Worse Than Death. How are you able to tell these stories and other stories about teens that are so on the spot in capturing the social system that permeates many high schools?
Well, I was younger then. I was closer to high school when Seedfolks was written. I'm not sure I would say all that is true for me now. I've actually been writing for adults the last few years, and that's part of the reason. I feel I don't know teens as well. My wife and I have three, and they've all grown up and moved out. And the world has grown up and changed so quickly that I, quite frankly, don't feel that same connection. But back then I did. To be honest with you, I was afraid there wasn't enough about teens in the books, or kids in general. It was, after all, these were mainly adults who are my cast. And halfway through the book, I put it aside. I dropped it. I decided no one was going to read this, especially kids. Kids aren't going to read about gardening. There wasn't enough for them in it. And I would certainly understand that. A few months later, I picked it back up again and decided that, you know, where I could get kids in more easily and make some more connections. And I think there's just enough of them there. But certainly, they're kind of in the minority in the book, to tell you the truth. How do you plug into them? You actually write from within. I'm not a teenager anymore. But my books are quite autobiographical, but not in the usual A equals 1, B equals 2 way. I don't draw from real things that happened to me. I've written close to 40 books. Almost nothing from my actual life has been cut and pasted into those books. Nothing. All of it is imagined. But the roots are there, and the themes, and experiences, and you know, those things are universal. In the case of Gonzalo, you have a kid who's having to be the interpreter for his family. That's one that actually did come from outside my life. I was a volunteer in a junior high in my town, when I was writing the book and in an ESL class. And I found out in the course of that volunteer work that that was often the case with these kids. They grew up, they were the second generation, and so they bridged the worlds. They knew the native language and they knew English from growing up with it on TV and on the playground. And so that came from there. But the other themes in the book come from inside me. Various parts of my life are in all of those stories. But they're transformed. They're turned upside down, inside out. I'll just give you one example. The first story in the book, Kim, the little girl who starts the garden. What's her situation? Her father has died before she was born. She's planting the beans in hopes that his spirit can see them to earn his praise, his respect, and so that he can know her in some way. Was that my situation? Not at all. My father is still alive. He's still writing. My father didn't go away for work. He was just the opposite of her father. He was there every day. He just went downstairs and into his office. So I had a completely different childhood from hers. But we bear some things in common. It was my mother who died a few years before Seedfolks. And so this, in a way, was a bouquet of stories for her to see. And in a way, we never get over the need to impress our parents or make sure they love us or have their approval. And so those are the kind of universals that are lurk in the background of all the stories for me.
The growing the bean sprouts was, for me, a very spiritual story because it transcended logic, it transcended the rules. I should add Western rules, Western logic. And it helped us see that different people approach spirituality from different angles and get to the same end.
Uh-huh.
And I thought that was a real powerful part of the book.
I hadn't known I was going to write the book, and after I wrote that first chapter, I was kind of hooked myself. I decided, well, maybe I will.
I'm glad you did.
It just came out. I didn't really have it planned.
Our Back to Books program, one of the goals is to build bridges between cultures and to promote understanding between all walks of life. And this book was a complement to what we're, and augmented what we're trying to do. And
great.
That's one of the reasons it was selected.
I'm so pleased.
How have libraries been important to you or inspired you in both your personal life, your academic life, and your professional life?
Well, boy, I couldn't live without a library. I lived in Pacific Grove, California for many years, a kind of a small town about a quarter the size of Allen. And I was shocked when I found out that the library was having trouble getting some funding, and that of the 6 city council members, only one was a regular library user. The others weren't seen in there. I could not imagine that life of not buzzing into the library all the time. I now live about 30 miles north of there, and I'm kind of out in the country in between a bunch of other places. I have about 4 different library cards to a bunch of different systems, one of which has many different libraries connected to it. So like a bee in a clover patch, I am just always buzzing into libraries. For me, they've meant everything. First, of course, getting interested in books and reading in high school. I should admit I wasn't a reader for pleasure until high school. Before that, I was just doing other stuff. But then I caught the bug, and then I was in the Santa Monica Public Library and a nearby branch constantly, checking out way more books than I could read, books that were over my head or under my head, all kinds of books, good, bad, and indifferent. And that never stopped. I've still got a stack on the table. For research, of course, I use libraries all the time, as I did for Seedfolks. You know, that's where I go to find out what I don't know. As a place to write, I've written entire books in libraries. I've happened to live in a couple of places where there were medical libraries attached to medical schools. Those were great places to write. Why? Because they were quiet. The only other people in there were the interns sleeping who'd been up all the night before on their shifts. So I've written probably two or three or four books in libraries. Can't live without them. Couldn't imagine it. Long may they thrive. Sounds like Alan has a wonderful library. I can't wait to see it tomorrow.
Good. Last question, and I'm going to turn it over to Kurt. And this is a question everybody who works for a library wants people to hear the answer to. Whatever your answer is fine. What is the importance of reading to people's personal, professional, emotional well-being?
Well, I can't speak for them. I can just speak for me. I can't imagine a life without books. And so far, they're still holding their own against the computer, although they just have too many advantages. Their portability, their relative cheapness, the fact that you can make annotations in them and they stay. They're beautiful. They're beautifully designed. You read a book on a Kindle, every book looks the same. I'm prejudiced. I grew up with a printing press in the household, so I grew up setting type, and I'm very aware of just the visual side of books. So I love books. I mean, what do they mean? They mean everything. I mean, they're, you know, that's our cultural heritage. I mean, a library is like the memory of a culture. You walk in there, you're communing with all the people who've walked the earth before you in different times and different places. And to walk by it and not walk in a library is a great shame. There's a lot in there. So just a world I couldn't imagine living outside of any more than a whale could imagine not living in water.
Thank you. I'm just fascinated. I started thinking about different things. And I'll ask as a teacher a couple.
Sure.
You've written 40 books, and let's say teachers have read Seedfolks this year. What other books that you've written would you suggest that would be great companions to, maybe not companions, but books that you think they would enjoy also that you've written?
You know, it's rare to get a question you haven't been asked before, and a pleasure. Well, let's start with books for younger kids. Westlandia would be a natural one. It's about a kid who founds a civilization in his backyard through a plant and everything that can be done with that plant, the leaves, the roots, the juice, everything. So that would be a natural one. I've written about plants a lot, probably because of my youth with all those plants. A book called The Animal Hedge. And my very first book was called The Birthday Tree, which was inspired by the tree in front of the house I grew up in. That tree had been planted to celebrate the birth of a child born in the family who lived in the house before my family. So that was re-illustrated recently and re-released. So those would all go along with Seedfolks there. For older kids, well, Tom talked about or asked me about Multiple Voices, the books of poetry for two voices, which are also natural subjects. I Am Phoenix, Joyful Noise, would certainly make sense. And the other multi-voice books are Bull Run, Big Talk, and then Seek. So, and if you like going even further towards plays, there's an actual play called Zap, which is even more multi-voice because there's seven plays mixed together in one. So it's kind of a train wreck of plays. Parodies of the standard theatrical fare. Other books for older readers that might go along with Seedfolks? Well, probably Breakout. That's a book for high school. About a girl. It also bridges prose to plays. So it's half of her account of being stuck in an all-day traffic jam in Los Angeles based on a real case. Lasted from 7 a.m. till 4. or so, and mixed in with a play she writes, a one-woman play, later. So it has a flash forward that we go back and forth. But it concerns community in the same way, in some ways, has some connections. And in her play, she takes on the roles of various people stuck in the traffic jam, in her fictional traffic jam. So it's a little bit the same, creating a number of characters who are in the same place. I think teachers would get something out of all those books. I thought I was going to be a teacher when I was about to graduate from college. And so I often write for the teacher that I didn't become. Books that I would have liked using. I thought I'd be a history teacher. So I wrote a lot of historical fiction early on, and a lot of my books are taught with the classroom in mind and that scale in mind. You know, I don't write for Carnegie Hall. I write for just two people or a classroom. You know, a classroom can read Seek out loud. A classroom can read Mind's Eye, a one-act play I did. I love that consort feeling where you all have a part. You're pitching in. There's that synergy, you know? If everybody reads their part, you end up with this play and this shared experience. A lot like playing in an orchestra. So, thank you for asking.
That was great. You've written a lot about historical perspectives and history. You've obviously read a lot. What's your favorite part or time in history that you enjoy reading and maybe writing about the most?
Well, the one I've written about the most is the colonial period, and that is because when I was 19, I left California and took a long bicycle trip north, then east, took the train across Canada, and ended up being a caretaker of a 200-year house in the woods of New Hampshire. You would have loved it there. I did not grow up knowing a lot about nature, and it's rather shocking when I think all that I didn't know upon graduation from Santa Monica High School. We knew nothing about our climate, our plants, our natural history, where we got our water, where we got our power, how anything worked. We knew nothing. It was all, you know, abstract things. Well, living in a house back there in the woods with a little clearing, the maple trees, a creek, and about a half-hour walk down to the road, that was my education, walking that road at all times and all seasons, in the middle of the night. I got to know the constellations. I got to know the barks of the trees. I got to know the wildflowers in the spring and the summer. I especially got to know the birds. And when I heard a bird I didn't know, out the house I went. And I just didn't have binoculars. I didn't have a bird book. I just stalked it. I got as close as I could. And I noticed as much as I could and tried to remember as much as I could. And I still have the notebook in which I took all those notes. And so that was my education in natural history. And when I went to write children's books some years after that, I went back to New England mentally and wrote a number of books set in the colonial period. Because I had lived in this house for several years. There was a little cemetery next to the house in which the people who would live there before me were born. You could see their names, you could see the dates. And the dates were fairly close together. Life expectancy back then was about 38. 39, 40, you know, which basically meant if you got out of infancy, you were probably good to 70 or 80, but you were lucky. So I was fascinated by that period. I was waking up in the same bedroom that those people had awakened in the same house. It was built in 1770, looking out at the same range of hills. We took our water from the creek. We had a pipe with gravity feed. They probably didn't have that, but it was the same creek. We heated with wood one of the years I was there from the same forest. And indeed, if you walked through the forest, you would come to their old apple orchard, which was completely overgrown by the time I got there. But there it was. And you would come across the occasional house foundation, and you would wonder, who lived there? That's a great experience.
That's a deep connection to a place. Do you do that? You've talked about living in different places. Have you been able to do that in different places where you've lived long enough to?
I have. New Hampshire was special. I mean, a shiver went through me living there that kind of never left. That's the kind of shiver that I think probably has gone through most of your history teachers. You have that connection with a time, something that goes through you. It happened for me in New Mexico. I had so much fun moving to a brand new place from California to the woods of New Hampshire that I did it again. I went to New Mexico and finished my college there. I knew nobody, had never been there, no one in my family had ever been there. Perfect. Brand new part of the country, completely different region. And I fell in love with it. And I always felt quite at home there. Looking at the Sandia Mountains to the east, the climate, the food, the weather, the people, the music, it was all just a perfect whole. And as many people who've lived in New Mexico did, I moved away but came back. And so I lived there twice and then came back one summer, a second summer, a third summer, a fourth summer, a fifth summer over the years. I've been back many, many times for the whole summer. I love summer there and many other times too. So yeah, I've definitely felt it there. I've lived a lot of other places. When my kids were young, we went away every summer and I would just write. So Seedfolks was written partly in North Carolina, New Hampshire, some two summers there, Louisiana, Mexico, New Mexico. But I'd have to say New England and New Mexico. So those, that and California where I grew up, those are the only places where the roots are that deep, you know. Okay. Yeah.
When you were growing up in a different place, were you able to meet a lot of different people from different parts of the country, different parts of the world? Did they have an influence on some of the ways you think about cultures and?
Uh-huh. Not too much. I mean, Santa Monica, where I grew up, was upper middle class and mainly white. Although in my high school, there were certainly all races represented. But travel was not part of my youth. I had a...
You mentioned last time that you and your neighbors were butchering your own hogs. That was...
Yeah. Yeah, my wife and I have gone in with another neighbor, and so it's a great biology lesson, I tell you.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
We're ready to go.
So. Oh,
okay.
Wow. Young at heart.
Young at heart. I knew it had heart.
I know it.
Yeah.
Come back.
Great.
It takes a while.
Okay.
Well, to answer your question, Kirk, I have never lived in a place that's like the neighborhood in Seedfolks. You know, I brought together, you know, different characters, different experiences. I've been in all the states of the United States except two, and I've lived in a fair number of them, but never quite in that community exactly. I haven't lived in that many big cities, to tell you the truth, even though I grew up in L.A., went to school in Berkeley, in part, lived in Albuquerque for many years. Albuquerque would be the closest. I mean, half of Albuquerque, Spanish is the first language there, so it's a little more like that neighborhood, perhaps. But no, you know, writers invent characters and put themselves into the characters. That's what we do, and you research what you need to know. So it's half imagination and half experience.
If a teacher, a lot of times you have 15 minutes or maybe a time to read a chapter. If they picked up Seedfolks, well, someone had handed it to them and said, you know, if you get the chance, read this to your students. And, you know, teachers are stretched in many different directions. Is there one chapter in Seedfolks that teachers would, that you would say, hey, try this one, that would, I don't know.
Well, I'd probably send them to the first chapter because that sets it all in motion. But other than that, I don't have a favorite. You know, the whole thing, it's a whole.
Absolutely.
Or it should be. It should be. So I would send them to the first chapter. If they can stop reading after that, it's not their cup of tea.
One little last question. I had a professor in college that I didn't understand at the time said that a lot of times professors on their first, or writers on their first book, their very first book, it's simply an autobiography of their life, and they don't start using their imagination until the next book.
Well, I'm not sure that that statistics would bear that out. I think generally the first books are more drawn from real life, and the proportion of imagination increases later on. With me, it's been the same, but as I say, it's transformed. So, you know, I'm 56 right now, but I still do write books for kids, little kids, that have an autobiographical element. You just find a way to change it. That's the little, you know, it's like inside of the sun, you've got helium and hydrogen, right? Well, you have to have some little germ inside the book for the author. That's what pulses, that's what gives it life. And usually you find that inside. Usually you don't find that somewhere else. You know, the outer skin might be out there. I've gotten a lot of books out of reading the newspaper, believe me. But the heart of the book comes from inside, for me. But you've got somebody like Harper Lee with The Kill of Mockingbird, highly autobiographical. And then she was done. The more imagination in your proportions, the longer writing career you may have, because you've got a lot more material.
Thank you so much for the interview.
My pleasure.